you should not go all out to impress people with your writing. See, writing is something that should come naturally. Writing is something that should come spontaneously. Otherwise, your writing will be labored, will look a little artificial. Right. If you are trying to make an effort. See, I really don't think that people should use big words because those big words will impress the readers. No.
Hello and welcome to another episode of Leisurely Mind. My guest today is renowned author Khyrunnisa. She is a renowned children's author as well as creator of popular comic character Butterfinger, which gained popularity initially in Tinkle and appeared in that magazine. Ma'am, welcome to Leisurely Baatein. How are you doing?
Thank you very much, Subhadip, for inviting me to be part of your show. It's a privilege and I'm doing fine. And it's great to meet you, not in person, but to virtually meet you, which is the second best thing I think these days. Okay.
But I was very intrigued. I'm very intrigued to understand that. Was it your ambition to be an author, or you would say, you know, you're an accidental author?
Yeah, I think most people will say we have always wanted to write. We have, this was the ambition, or if not the actual obvious visible ambition, at least a secret ambition. But in my case, I think that word you used is right, accident. Because that, I love writing. Writing in the sense, you know, I love the English language. Right. In school, and I've always loved reading. English is very special for me. I used to read a lot. And in school, I used to enjoy the periods, the classes, English classes. I like to write. I wanted to write a little different from others. Mm-hmm. But that does not mean that you want to become a writer. Right. So, you know, there's a difference between wanting to write, enjoying writing, and wishing to become a writer. So, because when you think of becoming an author or a writer, it means you have books published in your name. They are out there in public. So, that's a huge ambition. And now you find little children having their books published. You know, you must be aware of that.
Yes.
Fond parents find children putting sentences together. Have put in together and get them published. So that's happening. And in my case, that was not there. Anyway, I come from a large family. I'm the youngest of 8 children. Mm-hmm. And so we all kind of grew up, you know, we just in a large family. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So what happened, the way I came into writing, so I'm not saying that I did not want to become a writer at all, because quite likely inside me, I would have wanted to become a writer. Otherwise, I would not have taken those steps that eventually led me to become a published writer. Sure. Yet it was not there in my mind, foremost in my mind, or that great desire. So what happened? Do you want the story for that, or are you going?
Yeah, it'd be good to understand that. Yeah, it'd be very good.
Yeah. So yes, this was happening, and then I took English literature. Quite against the desires of my parents. You know how my parents, my sisters, right. They wanted me to do medicine. Right. You know how it is. Yeah.
Absolutely.
If you do well in the 10th, you have to go for engineering or medicine. Then no other option.
Right.
And I had to fight. I had to argue. And my father backed me. He said, you do literature, you take that if you like it. And that's how I took literature. I was happy and I was going on with that. And I used to, in school, in college, write for the college magazine. You know, those competitions in college, you have the short story, poetry, those kind of things I used to join. Then All India Radio used to request, you know, they have a youth program. Mm-hmm. And they have slots for different colleges sometimes. And they would ask, and my teachers would ask me whether I could write a story to read out there. So those kind of little things were happening. But at the same time, I was pursuing my love for English was foremost. And then I went to work in the college school for some time, then a college for some time, and then I went to the bank, Punjab National Bank, where I realized that the banking is, I'm not cut out to be a banker. Yeah, it's not an office job. It's not like Charles Lamb said, the wood went into my soul. So he hated his office job. I did enjoy those 2 years at the bank, my training period. I went all over India. I enjoyed, I made a lot of good friends. We are still friends. All that was fine. But as a career, I didn't want to be a banker. And I was craving to get back to English, to teaching English literature. And finally, I managed that. I resigned from my bank job. Everyone said I was crazy. You're mad, they said, to do this. Because my salary at that time was, in the college, was one third was what I was getting in the bank. So, you know how it is. For everybody, it is the salary that matters. How can you even think of leaving a job that everybody covets, which is paying you so much, and willingly going for something that is so lowly paid? I said, fine, I'll do that. I can manage to live within the salary I'm getting. I'm going to get a lot of job satisfaction. That's what happened. So then I did that. My husband was also teaching in a college. And then we have a son. And so that was happening. One day there was this magazine called, you know, Tinkle magazine. You mentioned
that. Yes, absolutely. And that's something we grew up, you know, reading and
learning like that. Correct. Yeah.
It's very popular.
Yeah. Even now, I think when someone sees a Tinkle, however old or young you are, your hand reaches
out to it.
Yeah. And you want to read. Whatever it is. So there was a competition. They called for entries for a competition for adult writers of children's fiction. And then I thought, why not write a story? So that is why I think, though I tell you it is quite by accident, I need not have responded, right?
Right.
The fact that I responded means I did want to write. And I sent an entry. That entry, so this is a 3,000 word story. It has to be, you know, the stipulations.
Right.
And I thought, okay, I will write. And when you are sending an entry, you know how it is. You say, I'll be telling you, and you ask me, I'll say, oh, I entered just for a lark. Right. I didn't really bother about a prize. I just wanted to enter. You say all these grand things, but actually in your heart, you would like to get the prize.
Some recognition.
Yes, you would like to put in your best, whatever it is. You are doing something, it's a competition. And by the way, when I was in school and college, I always liked exams. Strange person I am. Right? You know why? Because the rest of the time I wanted to read books, other books.
Right.
Not my syllabus. Yeah.
Right.
So when exams come, I really study. So I need exams to do well. So that way I quite enjoyed writing exams. And there's this competition. And I thought I will write a humor story. Humorous story, because at home, I told you, we are a large family. And we kind of, to survive, you need to use humor. Right. 7 girls and 1 boy, and the youngest. So you can imagine how it would be. You need to learn how to repartee, retort, to think on your feet. You have to hold your own. So I got all the training at home.
Right.
And my sisters, all of them, they were in different colleges and schools. So every 2 years, there is a sibling, okay?
Right.
If I'm 8, 10, 12, my father was very regular. And we used to share stories about school, college. But what is important here is that my house had a lot of books.
Right.
We all loved reading. And used to fight over books, what to read. If someone is reading, I want to read. You know how it is.
Right.
And therefore, that love was very important for books and reading.
Right.
And when I saw this competition, I thought I will send an entry. And I thought, and because I love humor, that's my weakness. Mm-hmm. I read different kinds of books, but my special liking is for humorous books. Mm-hmm. And therefore, and when I used to write in school, composition, essays and so on, I would like to bring some humor in them. Right. And this was pre-email days. We used to write letters. And when I write letters to my friends or relatives, I would like to make them funny. To bring in some humor. So that was, nobody told me to, it was like a compulsion for me. Right. And I was doing that. Therefore, I thought I will write a humorous story. So that was one. Second, I love sports. At home, we, especially cricket, you know how cricket is India's religion, right? And we watch, it was the radio commentary first and then TV.
Right.
Listen, watch, and though you know what has happened, when the newspaper comes, you pull it and you read what has happened. You know what has happened, but again, you want to read it. I read the newspaper back to front,
yes. I remember I used to get heavily scolded for that, you know, by my father.
Yeah.
And sometimes I used to take the first and the last page, you know, because he used to get so...
You could just take that away, yeah.
He couldn't read the headlines, and I can relate it very well.
So that's what happened. Very often the paper, we would be in tatters, you know, because everyone wants to read the same. And since that was how it was, and I also realized there aren't too many sports-based stories. Right. This is a story, this is a competition for adult writers of children's fiction. So I have to write a story for children. I have not found too many stories, sports-based stories for children. So I thought, okay, then I will write a cricket-based story since I'm comfortable with cricket. I know cricket. I don't play cricket. We play all those stupid, idiotic, you have a kind of a wooden or a plastic bat,
right,
table tennis ball. We have our own rules and we play cricket.
Right.
That's the kind of cricket we used to play. But I know cricket. And therefore, I thought I'm right. And as I told you earlier, we are a large family.
Right.
You drop things here and there. And Butterfingers is a word constantly used at home.
Right.
Yes, it is a word that has been in the English language for a very long time.
Right.
And a clumsy person, and things drop from your hand and things break, you're called, dubbed Butterfingers.
Right.
And anyone drops something, you call that person Butterfingers. Here, this one is Butterfingers. So therefore, I thought, why not have a story where the main character's nickname is Butterfingers?
Mm-hmm.
And I'm already thinking of writing a cricket-based story. Therefore, imagine a Butterfingers on the cricket field, the last person who should be on the cricket field. I realized I could generate a lot of fun.
Right.
The story could be funny because the character is Butterfingers. At the same time, he's a hero. So his being Butterfingers should actually help the team. I was thinking on those lines.
Right.
And I sent this entry. The title of the story was Butterfingers.
Right.
And I got the second prize at the competition.
Wow.
Which made me happy because it's an All India competition. So to get the second prize is not it's not a great thing, but it is not bad. I was pleased with that. I really don't know, but I feel happy about that.
Sure.
And that would have been the end of the story. You would not have been here talking to me asking all this if something else had not happened. Now, what that was a few months later, we had a visitor at home.
Mm-hmm.
That was a lady. She was with her husband, he was her husband. And she turned out stranger. She had my address in her hand. And she was the assistant editor of Tinkle.
Wow.
And she said, Tinkle is based in Mumbai, as you know, and I'm in Trivandrum, you know, not like Delhi and Trivandrum, but it's far enough, you know, Mumbai and then just Bombay and Trivandrum. And she told me that her in-laws are in Trivandrum and she was coming to Trivandrum to meet her in-laws. And in Tinkle office, they loved my story apparently. They found it real fun. They all enjoyed it. So they told her, if you're going to Trivandrum, if you have the time, why don't you look up this, not even a writer or an author, just one trick pony kind of one story I've written, and go and meet her if you can. Right. She actually did. I was overwhelmed. Imagine having an editor coming to your house on the basis of one story that you have written. So I was very happy. We got talking, and then we found a lot of things to talk about. And connections. Trenum is a small city.
Right.
And she asked me, are you sending an entry for the next year's competition? You know, I told her, no, I'm not. She asked me, why? I said, because I've already got a prize. So she said, you got one prize and you are so pleased. You should have more ambition. And she told me, you have to write. It's not that I did not, it's just that I never thought of entering for this next year, because I don't know whether I thought maybe if you have won a prize, you cannot. You know, they have these kind of rules. I did not even restrictions. I did not look too deep into that or anything, just that I didn't think of writing or sending an entry for the next year's competition. So she said, no, there's nothing like that. We go by the quality of the story. You send an entry, an independent panel of judges judge. And if your story is good, it will get a prize. But you have to write, she said. Sure. And this kind of encouragement helped me. And I sent an entry for the next year's competition. I titled it Sourpuss. It got the first prize. Mm-hmm. And that was the beginning of the story. Wow. The writing bug bit me a little bit. Nipped me, you could say.
But you've been a prolific, author of children's literature, and
yes.
I mean, what made you, what inspired you to, write majority of your body of work in this genre? Because it's not an easy genre, it's quite a difficult genre, I must say.
Correct. It's not easy. There are two things about this. One, it's not easy to write for children. At the same time, people don't take writing for children too seriously. They kind of, I don't know, you also must be aware of that, that a lot of people think of it as second-class literature, or they know children need to read books. They know children's fiction is important. But when it comes to a choice between writing for adults and writing for children, writing for adults is there at the top, and only after that comes children's fiction. I mean, we have to understand that that's how it is. Why this happens, I don't know, but that is the sad reality. Your question about whether why I chose to write for children is connected to what I had been telling you earlier, because if you call me an accidental writer, you could also call me an accidental children's writer. Yeah, because I started off that way. I sent this entry for it. Had it been a magazine which was calling for a story for adult writers, and I got the prize there, I might have gone into writing for adults right from the beginning. You get me? So this happened, then the next year I entered this competition again, and then for several years I was doing that, and Children's Book Trust, I sent entries, and I found that I was able to write books stories which children could relate to, which were fun stories, and which were getting recognition. See, getting recognition is very important. It is very encouraging.
Absolutely.
And yeah. So that is what happened, and I was writing. Meanwhile, like I said, this writing started. I was writing here and there, but I was totally involved in my work in college. I was teaching in a college, and there I need to put in a lot of effort for my lectures. I have to do a lot of reading. My son is growing up. I have to take care of my home. So many things are happening. So writing was happening, you could say, a little secretly. On the side. A lot of my friends did not even know I was writing. I did not even tell people about what I'm doing. It's almost like it's a special secret that I was holding close to my heart. And so that was happening. And then Indian Express asked me to write a column for their paper about classics, about books, which I was very happy about, because I could go back to books. I used to read the books and write something about that. I really enjoyed it. So very nice. From 1999 to 2007, it ran a fortnightly column. And that was happening. So there was some writing happening, and then Outlook Traveler asked me to write something about Trivandrum and the nearby places, Padmanabhapuram Palace and so on. So I was doing all kinds of this kind of writing. Mm. And meanwhile, it was writing for children that was happening.
Right.
So like you said, that is how it happened. Yeah.
Right. I wanted to, you know, ask you, you know, as an author, what do you emphasize more on, you know, use of complex vocabulary to be recognized or to be noted as an author, or use of simple words, you know, that express complex emotions?
I really don't think that you should not go all out to impress people with your writing. See, writing is something that should come naturally. Writing is something that should come spontaneously. Otherwise, your writing will be labored, will look a little artificial. Right. If you are trying to make an effort. See, I really don't think that people should use big words because those big words will impress the readers. No. See, readers want something that is good writing. Good writing, you find we find Moby Dick's opening lines, call me Ishmael. What is so grand about it? Call me Ishmael. Considered one of the best opening sentences. And you find, if you look at great writing, it is only simple words, but very effective and put together so beautifully that the effect is in the way in which these words are crafted into a sentence. It is not the use of big words. If you feel like using big words, if you think this big word will be suitable, because I love using rather not big words, but you have a good vocabulary. When you have a good vocabulary, naturally you use some words.
Right.
You're not using the words for effect. So that's what I want to tell you. It's not a kind of like complex emotions should be represented through simple language, or simple emotions should be represented, should be enhanced by the use of complex vocabulary. I don't know, and I really hope writers don't think like that, don't think of writing like that, because I think it will take away something from the effect of the writing. So for me, it's what I feel. But when I write, I have something I want to write, and I put that in words. And I feel it for what I'm writing. It should be the best words in the best order. That is for my purpose.
Right.
It could now be simple just, words.
Engrossed, you know, listening as a student, you know, in.
Very good.
Moving ahead, I wanted to ask you a question which not only me, but you know, I'm sure there would be a lot of aspiring authors who may have a similar question. And what I wanted to ask you about is, do you think an author should stick to a specific genre of writing, or should experiment between genres?
Well, I seriously feel that if you have that kind of time, the luxury of time to experiment, you should. Because what they say about writing is, you probably think that you are good at one genre, but quite likely you may be better at another. So unless you write, how will you know?
Right.
See, in my case, I was writing short stories, and my first book. So when I was telling you about my journey and how Tinkle, after a few years, asked me. By then, Tinkle was familiar with my writing, and they asked me to create a regular character for their magazine. You know, they have their Shikari, Shambhu, Supandi, all those. So like that, they wanted a regular character. So I went back to my first story, Butterfingers, because I felt that character was a lovely, fun-filled character. Children could relate to him. He was living in to other characters after that. So I suggested, why don't we bring him back? And they said, send three stories. Anyway, whatever it is, Butterfingers became a huge hit. It became a regular character, and it became a huge hit. So the way it works is, the short, I write long stories. There are three people involved in this. So I write a story of about, say, 2,000, 2,500 words. Then a script writer turns it into a script, you know, for comic strip. Then the third person comes into the picture, that is the illustrator.
Right.
So he illustrates. things, all right? First, I was very unhappy because my story, the first story, Butterfingers, was almost 3,000 words and it got reduced to 9 pages of comic strip. I realized that was a different literary form altogether and I got used to it. But what I did, and I'm very happy about that, I did not compromise on my writing style. I knew that they would do this, so I could have simplified and written only, you know, the fun part, the incidents. That's what you want in a comic. Right. Something. You know, it should be a page turner.
Right.
But I continued to write like that because I put in a lot of dialogue. So the scriptwriters are generally happy with my stories. Easy for them to script it. And the longer stories, copyright is with me. The right. comic strip is with First India Book House, then it became Amar Chitra Katha.
Right.
And so then this idea got formed in my head, maybe I could compile these stories into in book form. And with that idea, with these stories, I approached Penguin. That is Puffin, the children's imprint of Penguin.
Correct.
Thankfully, that editor liked the stories. But why I'm telling you this is, she got back to me saying, I love the stories, the concept, the idea of Butterfingers, the fun, the school atmosphere, the sports, everything, but we don't want short stories. Can you write a novel? So the request came from there. Now, I was not thinking of writing a novel. I'd never had it in my head. I could write a novel. I didn't think about it, just like I never thought of wanting to become a writer. But when she said this, I thought, well, I'm getting this offer from the other side. So let me see if I can write a novel.
Right.
So I told her, let me see. And I sent her a synopsis. She said, you send me the synopsis. She liked it, which was more or less the first story's synopsis, because I knew I could flesh it out. And then she asked me to send 2 chapters. I sent those. And then what did she send? She sent me the contract for the novel.
Wonderful.
Yes, that's the story of my first book, which is this book, How's That? Butterfingers.
100%.
And this is a novel. See, I was not planning to write a novel, but I took up that challenge and I wrote the novel and it became a big success. Even now, though it is 2010, it's gone into several reprints, it's doing very well. So, and because it's doing well, they said, why not have a series, Butterfingers series. And second, Gold Butterfingers, football-based novel, again a novel.
Right.
Third, Clean Bold Butterfingers.
Wow.
Another cricket-based novel. And after these 3 novels, they said, now we will publish your short stories.
Wow.
Yeah. Wow. And followed by 3 collections of short stories. And now I'm writing another novel. I've just finished it.
Wow.
It's a badminton-based novel, Butterfingers.
Wow. Yes. What I wanted to also ask from you, ma'am, is, you know, is there a process that you follow for your writing? I mean, do you go to maybe a secluded place or
romance
of writing, or how does how do you motivate or inspire
yourself?
Nobody
should follow my methods. Because you won't be able to write anything. Because I work in a very strange way. I really don't have a specific... I mean, I sit at my table because my desktop is there. That is why. I write my stories on my computer. I have a desktop. Because of that, I go there. But my table is a little cluttered. You will say, you will think of people saying a writer will sit very quietly in a very neat room and everything will be peaceful and quiet. And no, I will be doing something else and I'll jump here. I will write for a little while. Then I'll go. I have to do something else. I'm not an organized writer. But most of my writing has been, what to say, I've been writing with a deadline ahead of me because I've been writing under contract. So when you're writing under contract, you have this much time, say 6 months.
Right.
But that is a deadline. Even if it is 6 months, it is there. So I know within 6 months, I have to write.
Right.
And therefore, I plan it in my head how to write and so on. But I don't have a specific time when I write. See, the first 2 books I was writing, when I was teaching, I was writing. So I need to give time for my other activities and then sneak some time for my book. It's not easy, but thankfully I have one ability which I'm very glad I have, which is to shut out noise.
Wow,
shut
wonderful.
Out noise. Yeah, when I'm writing, I'm so absorbed in it. If somebody is making a lot of noise around, if somebody is talking loudly, if there is loud music playing, I can't hear any of that.
Wonderful.
I get completely involved in what I am writing. That is what has helped me.
Wonderful. I mean, that absorption, it's not easy, and I think...
I don't know. I'm glad I have it, because otherwise I wouldn't be able to write, because there are too many things I have to do.
Yeah. And the reason why I ask this question is, you know, a lot of my friends and, you know, some of the, you know, especially, you know, there are some friends, you know, who are the wives of, you know, some of my classmates. They're, you know, good authors, good writers, and, you know, I've always tried to encourage them, you know.
Yeah.
You know, to write, you know, and this is what they've always said, that there's so many things happening, there's so much of chaos, you know, where do I find
time to
write?
Find
and,
time.
And I would ask them to, like, you know, especially, you know, put what you just, like how you explain and what your process in a loop and listen and learn and, you know, just embark on that journey.
Yeah, because they always say if you're waiting for an inspiration, if you want the right place to sit and write, you're never going to write. These are all actually, if you look at it, excuses not to write.
Right, 100%.
You really, writing is hard work, but writing is also commitment.
Right.
You need to give that time. You need to tell yourself you have to write. And you have to sit tight and write. That's very, very important. And
how do you feel, ma'am, I just wanted to...
Yeah.
Otherwise, I would have lost my chain of thought. Do you feel that when you finish a novel, like you've just finished a novel, as you said,
yes.
You feel that, you know, there is a big weight gone from your chest. And
yes.
Like, you know, it's like the same, you know, feeling as like after the exams. The exam is over.
Yes. It is like that. You feel the big load off your mind. See, creativity shouldn't actually be like sitting like a load on you.
Right.
But you have set yourself certain goals and you have to do it within a particular time. That itself is putting some pressure on you.
Right.
So when you finish something, there's a real joy. Hello, it's there. But then comes the next step. You finish the book. Now you want to make it better.
Right.
So you work, you rework, you're never happy. Even now when I take all these books, you know, for whatever people may have said about them, and my tongue-in-cheek, which you, my first book for adults, which you said that you're reading now. All of them, whatever it is, whatever the feedback and however much readers like it, I still think I could have done better.
Right. That's a wonderful
answer. I don't know whether you feel like that, but I always think, okay, I could have written this. I could have changed this. I could have brought this in, kind of thing. Which means your books don't really leave your mind. You know, they are all sitting there.
The characters are around you.
Yeah, characters are around you. Your books are also your world, actually.
Right, right. Yeah. Absolutely. Absolutely. What's the most difficult book you think you wrote and why?
Not think, I know which is the most difficult book I wrote, which is this book, the third novel.
Right.
Maybe other more difficult ones are coming, but this one, Clean Bold Butterfingers, my third novel. I'll tell you why it was difficult. That is because I wrote House and Butterfingers, which was a cricket-based book. Goal Butterfingers, which was a football-based book. And the third book that I wanted to write was a tennis book, tennis-based book, because these are the three games that I know very well. I follow very well. And I know everything, watch all the Grand Slams, you know how it is, cricket matches you watch, football, big, if it is any big league matches we watch, otherwise all the World Cup, all those. And hockey also I used to watch, only the finals and those kind of things, because India used to do well in hockey, of course, after that we nosedived and then you know, we haven't really recovered. But so what happened was I thought of this tennis, I even had a title, Advantage Butterfingers. And I told my editor, she liked. He said, fine, you start. I sent her the synopsis. She said, okay, you start. And I wrote three chapters. Because this 2012 Goal Butterfingers came. And then I started writing this. And I got, after a little while, she got back to me saying, see, we had another meeting and we feel that tennis won't work.
Mm-hmm.
maybe we would like a cricket based book. Mm-hmm. Now, that was a challenge for me because I've already written a cricket based book. And if the characters are the same, the background is the same, it's the same school because it's a series. So it's Butterfingers and his friends. And now I am asked to write another cricket-based story. So in my mind, I put a lot of thought into what I'm writing and so on. And I didn't want to duplicate anything. I didn't want the third book to have echoes of the first book, which is a cricket-based book. Therefore, I had to think of a plot which is completely different. So both are on cricket, but I have to think of a plot which is completely different, which people will not think of. How's that? There will be other echoes. Like there's a character who dies in the first book, and it is in his memory that 6 months later they have a match in this book and so on. But it's a totally different story. It's a crazy book. It's a total fun book. And once I struggled over it, in the sense it took a long time thinking about it and what I should write, will it work? Once I got it right and started writing, I really enjoyed writing it.
Right.
You should read it, okay? I want you to. So it's very special for me. And that is why there was this gap between the second and the third book. This book came out only in 2015 because I needed to redo everything, think of another book. But later, I was very happy that Penguin asked me not to write the tennis book, because even when I wanted to write the tennis book, one thing was troubling me. Tennis is an elite sport.
Right.
I don't want an elite sport in my book. I want a sport which children can play easily.
Right.
See, tennis, you know, the racket is very expensive. You need to go to a tennis court. Not everybody can play tennis. So just because I enjoyed, I mean, I know about tennis, I wanted to write.
Right.
Therefore, I'm grateful. Yeah. So that's how Clean Bowl came. And this book that I'm writing now is a badminton-based book.
Right.
Badminton is not an elite sport. And it's easy to play.
And it's accessible sport, you know what I mean?
Yeah, very accessible. And you find people, children, even on the streets, you will find them just playing badminton. So it's not like tennis. I'm actually very grateful now that they did not want the tennis book. Their reasons were different. Their reasons were probably commercial. Because cricket sells, tennis will not, may not. Yeah, that must have been the thinking process, the thought process. But for me, it worked. Yeah, so that was the most difficult.
Wow. We're almost towards the end of the show. Last question which I have for you is, what advice you would have for aspiring authors?
Advice? I hate giving advice, but maybe I will.
It's more towards like, you know, there are small things that people don't get false start.
I know. I was just pulling your leg. Because, you know, in school, in college, and you will find these parents saying, why don't you advise ours?
Right.
Children. So I know that if you start advising, the children won't listen to you at all. they just shut out what you're saying. So I said, no, I don't want to advise. It's better to put things in a diplomatic way so that they understand what they need to do and what they need not do. Anyway, so coming to what I would like to tell aspiring writers, this is my constant, this is what I always tell, which is read a lot. You must keep reading. If you have to become a good writer, you must be a voracious reader. You must read widely. You must read all kinds of books. Like you asked that question about genre, right? Read different genre. You never know. Suddenly you might think reading some poem, you might think you're good at poetry. Reading some non-fiction book, you might think maybe it's not fiction that you may be good at. You might be interested in facts and bringing them together in an interesting way. So I think what you need to do is to read, because it also opens your mind. It exposes you to different styles. It improves your language. Every book you read improves your language, so that your language becomes, it's second nature to you to write well. This becomes easy. So what I would like to tell them is keep writing also. You want to write, so write. But continue to read and keep writing. And it's writing is hard work. Don't worry about that. You continue to write, and don't, if you submit your manuscript and you get a rejection, rejection should never lead to dejection. You should take it in your stride. Because there are very great writers who have got any number of rejection slips. I think they've been collecting all of them. They've got 400 rejection slips, 300 rejection slips before they became hugely successful writers. So don't allow that to kind of, you know, cripple your creativity. Continue to keep writing. Be focused in what you're writing. Remember, it's hard work. Success will not come easily. You have to keep all this in mind. On the other side, it looks very nice. You're all successful writers. You have these books in bookshops. How do you feel to have so many books to your name and so on? All that has come after a lot of hard work.
Correct.
It's not easy. You're only seeing the end product. Correct. The process is a long process, a protracted process. It's a lot of hard work, a lot of sweat, not blood, but there's toil, sometimes tears and sweat. All that. And so my words to aspiring writers would be, I would wish them all the best. I would like them to keep reading and keep writing and never give up. You should continue to persevere in what you are doing and enjoy what you're doing. Enjoy writing.